Welcome, 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 everybody, to the Roadshow. Our food is here. We got food and drinks from Jerk Shack back in the middle of the room here. So please help yourselves. We'll get started in a few minutes here. We're so glad to see you. Thank you. everybody. Thank you for being here at our first road show. You know, it's been a while since we've done live and in-person events, so we're glad to be in this space with you. My name is Alex Rose. I work for the City of Seattle's Office of Arts and Culture, and it's my pleasure to welcome the director of our office to kick us off today. So Royal Allie Barnes, please make your way to the stage.
Thank you, Alex. Can you guys hear me? Can I see it again? Do that. Is it testing? Is it on? You know, I was looking at the KEPX song from yesterday, which was Take Me to Your Leader, right, by the Acid Group. Was it not yesterday? Yeah, it was yesterday, right? And I'm like, I wanted that song to be played while I was coming up here. Not because I'm the leader, but because this is the leadership. This is taking us to our leaders. Let's hear it for that. Really loud. Really, really loud. So even though I didn't get to have that entourage introduction myself, the leadership that's here today is everybody in this chair, everybody in this gathering space. This is about people, purpose, place. So I really thank you for letting me join you this afternoon. It's really my pleasure to be here. And I want you to know that the Office of Arts and Culture supports the music industry. Let's hear it for the music industry. I want to hear it loud. Just loud, loud. Woo! That's right. Hear it loud. Arts and culture, as you well know, because you're the makers and the future makers, are critical to our health, our emotional and our mental, and our aesthetic, artistic health. That's how we build a city that's innovative. When people gather, we open ourselves to new experiences out in the real world. At least five people came up to me today and said, oh, you're shorter than I thought. At least they didn't say you're fatter than I thought, right? Because I'm perfectly good with this weight level, right? But the big deal is that we can actually rub shoulders and we can rub elbows, and if you want, hug or shake hands, mask or unmask. I'm masked, I'm unmasked to talk to you because this is so very important to me. Art really impacts our worldview. Looking around here, it looks like an international gathering. It looks like a many, I don't know, I can't even tell you. You know, I can see linguistic here, I can see racial, I can see gender, I can see ascription, I can see generational. It's absolutely beautiful. This is how we make an innovative city. Music becomes the arteries that we all flow with and on. It goes right to our hearts. So we're now moving from that pandemic. I refuse to say post-pandemic because we don't know yet, right? But we are endemic. We are learning to live with what it feels like coming out of being sheltered, shuttered, stopped, paused. And our music, while we were in that pause phase, our music at different levels kept us sane, quite frankly. I want to hear it from music, keeping us sane, keeping us happy, keeping us wild, keeping us all the ways that human beings need to be. Let me hear it for that. I need to hear it for that. You know, when we talk about, or maybe I'm the only person who talks about it, but Mayor Harrell's One Seattle, it's exactly this. It's organizations, it's artists, it's musicians, it's communities, it's venues, it's small business. It is the heart and throbbing of our city. We've all got to work together because we're in this together. And you know, music is a big part of recovery, not simply individually in our lives, but for this city, for this city. You all know the big names, the big people, the big personas that kept this city not only on the map in the music industry nationally, but internationally. It takes people at every turn to make music, at every turn. Now, it's not a talent that I have. You don't want to hear me sing, I can guarantee you. But I do want to have this appreciation sound for every music maker in here. It goes like this. Will you join me? a continual celebration, a sound of shout. We have to be loud about this recovery. And music will help us do that. It has volume, it has voice, and it speaks to our hearts. So please, keep your voices loud. I also want to thank KEXP for hosting us in the gathering space. Big shout out for them, big shout out. And music at every turn always means volunteers at every turn. Let's hear it for our volunteers. Kudos to all of our volunteers. And let's give some public sector recognition. Council member, I think you're here, Sarah Nelson. Can you stand for us? If not, you hear it from us now. Thank you for supporting the music industry. And now it's my pleasure to introduce someone whom you all already know, but he was very clear, you will introduce me in these words. By name, Benjamin Hunter. Mr. Hunter, where are you?
I'm right here.
Thank you. As you know, Benjamin is an award-winning multi-instrumentalist, composer, cultural advocate, entrepreneur, producer, educator. He's also, fortunately for the City of Seattle and its partners, the artistic director of Northwest Folklife. And fortunately for us, the music industry and our community, a dedicated maker of the art. Mr. Hunter.
Talking about theme songs.
I was wondering,
you know what I'm saying? If I had a theme song when I walked in the door, you know what I'm saying? I'm just gonna wait. I'm not gonna moonwalk because I don't have those shoes on. I just watched Moonwalker last night. Y'all know what I'm talking about? That film from the 90s. Maybe some of y'all don't know. Look it up, Moonwalker, it's free on YouTube. Anyways, my name is Benjamin Hunter. Thank you, Ms. Barnes, for introducing me. I didn't require that those words be said, but you know, I'm not mad at you. Thank you guys all for being here today. Obviously, it's a moment for us to celebrate just in general, just to be in a room together. There's so many of my fellow music commissioners that I've just been seeing on a screen for the last 2.5 years, and to be able to hug them and see them and, dare I say, smell them, it feels good, you know? We can't forget that this whole music business, this whole entertainment business, this whole creative business is sensory, right? And we're here to make sure that we spread those sensory things out into the world for us all to engage with. I have a couple things I must say here. I want to make sure we give thanks to Climate Pledge. Give thanks to Jerk Shack for the food. Give thanks to GZ Radio. Give thanks to Vera Project. Today, we're going to hear from some wonderful people, folks that have, you know, spent much of their life engaging in this business. They have a lot of expertise. They have a lot of knowledge to share. And, you know, I think thankfully for us and this community and this city that we live in, you know, we pride ourselves on the fact that we want to share it, right? This business isn't something for us to keep locked in a lockbox. And I think that there are probably other cities out there in this country and in the world that have very designated and prescribed ways of doing things that maybe aren't necessarily in the spirit of sharing, but more in the spirit of competition. And I'm very proud to say that this city, at least for me and I think my colleagues in this room, have been able to develop because of the ability to share and to connect and to network and to collaborate and to cooperate, right? So that's why we're here today, and I appreciate you guys all being here for that. Name tags have not really been a thing for me. So I want to also just thank our speakers. Today we're gonna have Ms. Casey Carter, Mr. Mikey McClarron, Mr. Seven Spillios, Mr. Andrew Joslyn. And then we're also going to have some wonderful mentor opportunities, and that's going to be along this left side over here after the speakers. And we're going to have Jovino Santos. Give it up, give it up, give it up. We're going to have Mira Kraft. We're going to have TraeAnna Holiday. And we're going to have Shaina Foley. So give a big round of applause for all those folks. So basically what's going to happen is I'm going to stop talking. And we're going to bring some folks up here to talk a little bit about this business, right, that we're getting into. And then we're going to break off and do a Q&A, and we're going to get into these speed mentoring sessions. If I can ask folks from the Music Commission to all raise your hands, if you don't mind. Just put your hands up in the air. Give a round of applause for all these folks. If you find yourself standing in the middle of the room needing something to do, find one of these cats. Go up and just talk to them. Just stand in front of them and look at them. Be awkward about it. It's cool. We are here to serve you. We are here to answer questions and make sure that this event is something that we can continue on and roll on in the future so that these opportunities become a part of the fabric and the cultural fabric of this city, right? So make sure that you do that. Again, I'm going to stop talking, and please help me welcome our first two speakers, Ms. Casey Carter and Mr. Mike McClarron.
What would your song be, Mikey?
Ooh, you can't put me on the spot like that. Hold on. Okay.
I know what my song would be, that's why.
You know? Okay, you go first then.
It would be from Waka Flocka and Drake. It's called Round of Applause.
That would be
my song.
I think it'd be NERD Rockstar.
I love it. I love it.
Well, favorites.
Thank you guys so much for joining us. We're so excited to be here. I'm Miss Casey Carter.
I'm Mikey McClarron.
And Mikey and I come from a different background when it comes to music. We're both, well, Mikey's sort of an artist, but I am not an artist, but I come from just supporting the scene and giving my all into uplifting the community. So I think we'll have a different perspective on our roles in this industry.
For sure, for sure. Yeah. Do you want to start and let everyone know what your background is?
Yeah, let's get into it.
Let's see here.
Fun. Okay, so there's me, Miss Casey Carter. I started off by just, well, actually, let's get into the roles. So interviewer, founder, radio host, event producer, promoter, artist manager, connector, host, artist consulting, and then connector again. I've done almost any and everything when it comes to the music industry, worked the door, worked promotions, stood outside and handed out flyers and put them on your cars. I know that's so annoying, but I've done all of that except for being an artist. And then some of the projects I've started are, I had my own independent blog, MissCaseyCarter.com, and then I pivoted over to the blowup.co, which was focused on all independent artists. I started hosting the Glow Up podcast and then the Come Up on Cube 93, where we played nothing but new and local music, which was wonderful.
Yeah.
And then some of the other side projects I have are For the 99s and 2000s, which was a dance party that played nothing but throwback music for all my 2000 folks out there.
You got to bring that back, by the way.
It's coming back. It's coming back. And then lastly was a project I launched with my husband. It's called Bitch, I'm Hungry. And it's a web series where my husband gets high, Jar of D, and then he goes out and tries really great restaurants around Seattle. So check that out. So that's me.
So amazing. Casey really is amazing. She's done so much. And we've always crossed paths for many years, too. And I've seen her do incredible work for so long. So yeah.
Thank you, Mikey.
Props to you.
Let's get to know Mikey.
So me, I am a MC and host, a curator. I've been a creative director in the past, a social media manager. I guess I was kind of an artist manager briefly, sort of. Show producer, show promoter, a little bit of everything, honestly. Casey and I are very similar that way. In previous roles, I was the creative director for a space downtown called Spin. I also was a host for Red Bull for many years. Still am. They actually reached out to me the other day for some new stuff. I'm happy everything's back open. We outside again. It's so nice. Woo! It's so nice. Holy Shit Music Festival, curating and kind of helping out with programming for them. And I own a creative agency called Craving Amazing, which is everything between producing events, helping to curate lineups for events, and a number of different things. And I've done a couple different things around our city and a few different programs. Most recently, before everything shut down, I was doing a party called Pop Secret, which was a kind of a modern sound event over at Q Nightclub.
Awesome. And D-List Magazine, music editor.
Oh, that's right.
And
D-List Magazine, that was my very first thing long, long ago, too.
Well, let's talk about first things. How did we get started with everything? Let's see here. So, where it all began. So, I've always been a social butterfly. I've always just been the person where you want to know what's happening. I was the go-to person for that. And I fully immersed myself in the nightlife scene when I was of age. And with that, I also loved celebrity gossip. My family immigrated from the Philippines, and they loved like those tabloid magazines. So that's all we would have in the house. So I took my love for both of those things and created a blog spot, and would just go out in the nightlife scene, take pictures with everyone, and was really enjoying myself. And it wasn't until one of my good friends from high school took me to a local music show where I was like, oh, we actually have really great artists right here in our own backyard. And from that moment, I made it my mission to do any and everything I could to support the local talent here.
What show was it?
I remember it was Speedy the Artist and Brainstorm of Dime Def. They were performing at the Fremont, Nectar Lounge.
Shout out Nectar Lounge, by the way.
So from there, I just did any and everything I could to go to all the shows, connect with people, introduce myself, and I would take pictures with every single person. I'd be like, let's take a picture. And then I'd put it on my blog, and I just created a community that way. And here are some early photos. That first photo is us at the Nectar Lounge. And then another thing I would do was to get Seattle's name out there. I would travel to these music festivals and do my best at telling everyone about the Seattle music scene. So that's me at the A3C Music Hip Hop Festival down in Atlanta. And I went down there, I brought artist material with me, and you know, just did my part in spreading the word about everybody up here. And then lastly, it's the late, great Nipsey Hussle, rest in peace. That was actually my first artist interview I ever did back then. So I had a good friend who was like, you're doing all this cool stuff. Why don't you start doing artist interviews? Nipsey Hussle happened to be coming in the week of, and by the grace of God, I got that interview. So
that's amazing. I remember that interview, too.
Yeah.
And that was really dope.
Little baby Casey. Okay, let's get into your origin story.
So first of all, I think, like many of us, I'm a fan of music first, honestly. My very first concert ever at the Tacoma Dome, I was 12 years old, and shout out to my mom for taking me, my mom and my aunt. It was the Up and Smoke tour.
Oh, yes.
Crazy. That was my introduction to live music and shows, and so that was, led me on this path, I think, from a very, very young age. Here we see, I was at Coachella on behalf of Red Bull. We did there was a couple pop-ups there, and so Rome Fortune was one of the featured artists. So that was me and him there. Numo's actually was a show that was promoted by, we were talking about this earlier, Kitty and I, by Rain City and Obese. That might have been Obese Productions back then. Lupe Fiasco, when he first put out Food and Liquor. That's, 10 years ago now, 11 years ago now? Long time ago.
Yeah, maybe like and,
12. right. And the third one was a local party, probably my favorite party of all time. It was called Good Saturdays. And it was just a hip-hop party that we threw. It was at a few different places in the city. And that was where I really, kind of got my chops as a host and was able to really, same as Casey was saying, really get to meet everybody in the city. It was one of those parties that kind of everyone would flock to and be at all the time. And so I was able to meet so many people in so many different walks of life and stuff, but also get to be on the mic all the time like this and like build my presence and get those hours in. And it was amazing. Yeah.
So I think that's, I mean, it was a lot about us. Great job on everything, Mikey. I think it's a great perspective of showing like you can be in this industry without being an artist, and you can just find multiple ways of finding ways to support.
Absolutely.
Which brings us into building community. Here are a few photos of us just doing our thing with building community, but I'll say like building community and networking was like the heart and soul of what Miss Casey Carter was. Like I said, since I'm not an artist, I wanted to do everything I could to support the incredibly talented community we had here. And I wanted to always make sure I gave everybody a chance, whether that was posting their music on our blog or putting them on a show as support or main artist on our events. Even with interns, I would meet so many folks who would want to be in the industry, and I never gate kept those roles, and I just would always do my best into supporting everybody and giving them a chance. I personally know how it feels to be left out. I know how it feels to feel like people know stuff and they're just watching you kind of drown, and I never ever wanted anyone to feel that way. So.
For sure.
I just always made sure that I did my part in including everyone and also meeting everyone, because you just never know. Like, Seattle, it seems big, but it's pretty small.
Yeah, I totally agree, and I see even some familiar faces in here. My man was on the mic the other night with, I believe, Marshall. That was at the Neptune. Yeah, so good to see you, my brother. Same thing, and I think that I've been an artist in the past, so I kind of understand how it can be difficult to build a platform and to gain notoriety, to gain visibility. So for me, I've always been one that's, I've wanted to amplify everyone in the community as much as possible, trying to find those diamonds in the rough and people who deserve the attention, but for whatever reason, it may just not be coming, and trying to provide those spaces and those platforms and that agency for any of those people that are in our community, you know, and bringing that closer together, being a bridge for those that may have not worked together before, introducing people for collaborations and many things all around that. So,
yeah, what are some, I mean, I guess that's a question, is like, what are some of the ways that we've brought people together? So, yeah, I think bridging the gap is really, really important. I think a lot of times people are, I think as artists and creatives, we're all scared. There's like a lot of fear that we have, and I'll get into that in a little bit, but it's like, I don't want to reach out to that person because X, Y, Z. And
right.
I think our roles were so important as far as being that person to be like, letting them know, it's okay.
Yeah.
I got you. Let me introduce, we're all humans.
Right, right.
So.
I think that a lot more people are approachable and also eager to collaborate. So for those of you that may be new to the community, go out and talk to people, go out and meet people, say hello, introduce yourself, and allow yourself to receive that the same way.
Let the Seattle freeze. Like, don't
right.
believe it.
It's a thing, it's but a it thing. Doesn't have to be a thing. And we're testaments to that for sure, where you just have to really just be open to inviting in new energy and allowing yourself to be fluid that way and to, you know, to represent for what you want to represent for and just, you know, champion that.
What are some good ways that people can introduce? Because I always talk about this on my Instagram, where I'm always giving tips on my Instagram. You'll see me just giving really raw. Sometimes I feel like I'm being mean, but I'm just being very honest from my experience. But like, I always tell people, like, don't be overly thirsty.
Right, right. I think the one key is to be there, like to be present. Mm-hmm. So it's one of those things where there's no replacement for being there, for being present. Mm-hmm. So just going out, you might want to just go to a show that it might not even be music that you're interested in, but there could just be one person there that you might resonate with, that then that will turn into something completely unrelated to where you're at, right?
Yeah.
And trying to meet as many new people as possible, and just, yeah, I guess it would be really just talking to people, honestly.
And be genuine. I think a lot of times when we make that first impression, we're so like, okay, I only get this one shot. I have to sell myself at this moment. In all honesty, just being yourself and being on the receiving end of that energy is always just like, maybe I'm moving too fast and I'm not going to be able to reconnect with you, but I'll remember you the next time and remember that like our interaction was very real.
Right.
So.
Right.
Yes, okay. I love all. Do you want to talk about these pictures you have up here?
Sure. So starting from the left side, that one was actually at Pop Secret. That was myself, DJ Famous, who was my partner on the entire project. And that night was our headliner that night, who is my man Sango, who's here from Seattle as well. You guys might know that name. The middle one was in Eugene, Oregon, for Red Bull 3 Style. And that was super dope crowd. We had two of our local DJs that were in that competition, DJ Vega and DJ Supaji. So that was dope to go down there with them and for them to represent Seattle. They actually came in second and third place as well. So that was dope to have them on stage and for them to get some recognition like that. And the far right one was the late, great DMX. At an event that we did, it was called Sundown. It was a day party that transitioned into a nighttime event. And he was the headliner for that. And so that was cool as well because he hung out with us afterwards for like an hour and a half just because he loved the energy that Seattle brought. For the space that was at Aston Manor. So for the space that was at, it was a very different crowd than I think that would normally be there. And we kind of did that intentionally because we wanted to introduce people to a new space in a different way that they may not normally go to. And so it worked out really well. DMX loved it. We ended up doing like a cypher afterwards too. So that's crazy because I got to freestyle with DMX. Like,
wow. Did somebody
and
get that
a bunch
on
of
camera?
Other people too. It was crazy. Yeah.
Did somebody record that?
No. And absolutely, my phone died like right before. And yeah, it was like five local MCs that were able to rap with him. He gave us some really dope game too.
Dope. Well, my photos are with the community I built throughout the years. The first is with the Blow Up crew, those interns, and they became employees. We built a really great platform supporting the independent scene, and I love all those guys till this day. The second photo in the middle is of me with my Glow Up podcast hosts. Funny enough, Naomi with the curly hair, she actually started off as an intern as well and then became the co-host with me. So that was a great story. And then lastly, I have Michelle and Sylvia. We created this community event called Blossom where we invited women of color particularly and created this safe networking space. And that was one of my most favorite events. So
that event was dope.
I almost used
a photo of me and Syl as mine. So I'm happy I didn't because we would have had the same picture.
Yes. All right. So one thing that I wanted me and Mikey to talk about is pivoting. Because I think that's something that a lot of people can be afraid of. Or they may come in ungenuine and not know how to pivot. So do you want to share your example first?
Yeah, I can. I do a lot of pivoting. And I'm happy that I do it because it allowed me to become more rounded as a creative. But I've gone from originally I was a music journalist when I was working at the magazine. And then I decided I wanted to be an artist for a while. I love making music, and I think that if you love making music, just make it. You know, just make it. It's not about trying to, you know, become this famous artist or anything. Just do it because you love it. From there, I pivoted into working more on like back of house stuff and building out shows and stuff like that. But the importance of pivoting is that you want to be able to kind of see it from all sides. I think that will allow you to really have a better understanding for navigating the music industry. Because there's a lot of moving parts, and there's a lot of parts that you don't see. There's things like being a social media manager that is not something that you would immediately think about when you're thinking about what a career in music looks like, right? For a lot of up-and-coming artists, thinking about moving into a space like being in like an A&R is something that a lot of artists don't think or know about. And some people are really knowledgeable on music. So even though you could be a great artist, you can have a whole separate career as being an A&R and just being the person that really like moves the culture in that direction as far as like what the programming for music is, whether it's radio stations, mm-hmm. whether it's for a record label, et cetera, et cetera. So I think the idea of pivoting allows you to really have longevity in the industry.
Absolutely. And I think for me, that was one thing I struggled with during the pandemic was, you know, I was really into heavy throwing events really heavily, and just I'm a in-person person. I needed to see people, and it was really hard for me to know what my next role would be. And it was also fear of, like, am I am I not going to be Miss Casey Carter if I pivot? Like, if I, like, am I losing my identity? What are people going to say? Am I a failure because of all of this? And honestly, and like with the blow up, for example, when we shut that down, I was so scared to like be seen as a failure and like, look at her, she can't finish out this blog or something like that. But I had to be real with myself. And I also just followed my heart and like knew that it was time, like, blogs aren't even that popping anymore. So if I didn't pivot, then I wouldn't be where I'm at. So I'm always encouraging folks to explore pivoting and not being afraid to let something go or trying something different. I think for artists specifically, like you said, it's difficult for them because they want to be the star. They want to be the artist, and it is hard letting that go. But I think once you're able to kind of spread yourself and find out, like be able to still be in the industry and do what you love, but maybe not be that artist, it's okay. And then maybe,
sure.
And then maybe in 2 years, the opportunity comes and it's the right moment.
Yeah, so. And I think as any position in the music industry, you're kind of already wearing a lot of hats anyways. And so to think of it in more of a way that you can be functional in different positions as opposed to saying, oh, I can't do this position, so I have to go pivot over here. Think of it more like, I can be functional in all of these positions, so I might as well like lean into that and be that way intentionally.
Absolutely. All right. So Mikey and I put together a list of industry do's and don'ts. The first one I put down was be polite to everyone at the venue. I think this is just overlooked.
Yeah.
I think
managers love that one for sure.
You guys, we go into the venue. We get checked by these security guards. We have bartenders. We have all these folks who are making this event happen. And I think just as people, sometimes we forget to treat everyone as respectfully. Yeah. But we gotta be nice to these folks. We gotta be kind. These are actual humans. They're working. They're doing their job, and they're making it roll.
Yeah.
So, and then also, too, they talk. So that's why I'm really saying this, because if you're an asshole at the venue, you may not be able to come back.
That's what I was going to say. You are your resume. You're literally your walking resume as you move through these spaces. So really think of it like this. From the first person that you see to the last person that you see at an event, and that has nothing to do with someone that's working behind a counter, in front of the door, whatever. I'm saying literally from the first person that is behind you or in front of you in line, to the last person that you see before you get to your car, you should just be consciously thinking about, I am literally giving my resume to every single person that I see in this room. There could be someone that owns a whole separate venue. There could be someone that is a fellow musician that's on a bill with you going forward. There could be somebody that is a PR manager that is looking at whoever. Maybe they have your band or your agency or whatever on their radar about working with them or whatever, and they all are seeing and talking to each other and seeing you move through a space. So just think about that as you're moving through. Keep a smile on your face. And also, like I said earlier, just be open and receptive to inviting a new energy. It always works out.
This is a word of mouth industry.
Yeah.
So just be very mindful of that when you're coming to other spaces and knowing that people are watching and paying attention.
For sure. For sure.
What's yours next, Mikey?
Give yourself room to explore and learn. I think that you should always be a sponge as much as you can in any and all settings, and even things that are non-traditional to what you would, I guess, think about as in that industry. Like this, of course, is a music event right now, right? There's no music happening. Well, there is later, but there's no music happening right now. And but this is a music event, right? So you want to be able to be open and explore and learn while you're here. I'm learning while I'm here. I look forward to speaking with a lot of you afterwards and learning your stories and just, you know, soaking up as much information and knowledge as I can from all, you know, spaces and places.
Yes, and don't be afraid to support others, especially those who are doing what you want to do. It makes me sad when I see people get very upset when another person wins, when it's like, that should drive you, that should push you, and just never be upset because somebody else is winning,
exactly.
Because that's bad karma for you.
Right, it should be inspiration.
Yeah, support one another and uplift your community. That's how we all win. Don't be afraid to do that.
Yeah. Taking time to prepare. That in so many ways is obviously so important. I actually have a little story. My computer went toast.
Oh, yeah.
Yesterday. And I was supposed to send Casey a bunch of stuff, and my computer went toast. Thankfully, I had the draft ready, so I had the photos that I had already pulled, and that was literally an example of being prepared. I had no idea. I was using it the entire day, and then it literally went toast at, like, 6 o'clock at night. And I was like, oh, God. And
that's
then I
was the like, music industry, that's, though. That's yeah. the creative world. Things will happen right yep. when you need them.
Definitely.
Well, my last one is a silly one, but I'm sure all my folks who are on email will feel this one. Know how to use reply all. Please know how to reply all. If there is something you're communicating to a whole group in an email, hit reply all. If there is a message that you just want to tell that one person, don't hit reply all. It's so small, I know, but I'm so silly for that one. But my goodness, you guys don't understand.
This sounds like you might have did that once or twice.
No, not me.
Okay.
I'm very, I'm very versed in reply all. So if you have questions about reply all, I will be out there to answer them. Let's talk about some don'ts. I'll start. Don't be afraid to ask questions. I think we're all, a lot of times we get scared, like, are they going to judge me for not knowing this or, you know, whatever reason may be. But I'm always asking questions. I'm always never afraid to hit somebody up to just get the answer really quick. I'll do research if I have to. But if I need to ask a question and I know somebody who knows it, I'm going to ask. Like, just ask as much as you can.
Yeah, absolutely. Don't be afraid to say no to opportunities. If you are presented with an opportunity, sometimes it might not be ideal to what your overall goals are. However, there's always that silver lining. There's always those hidden messages and hidden gifts within opportunities. So don't be afraid to say no. If something doesn't align with exactly what your path is in that moment, assess it, reassess it, maybe take a shot at it. Worst case scenario, if you weren't busy, then you were just busy with something and it didn't pan out. But at least in that moment, you can say, okay, well, I could have got something from this. And in certain cases, you do get something from it.
I used to be afraid of saying no, honestly. I always used to try and take every opportunity, and you burn yourself out. You spread yourself thin. You sometimes don't remain genuine to your mission. So it's okay to say no, and you'll start to see all of these other opportunities that you want to say yes to come about. It's a weird thing.
For sure.
Don't think anyone owes you anything. I think that people will do favors for each other, do something, or know somebody from high school. I know that would happen to me a lot. Is like we would know each other from the past, and people would just expect from you.
Yeah.
I mean, down to just getting you on the list. Mikey, I know you know about getting people on the list.
That's okay. But I always will, though. I'm always on the list.
No, but just, I mean, if you don't go out thinking people owe you anything, and I promise you won't get your heart broken. Just,
yeah.
You know, it kind of bleeds into don't take anything personal as well for me, where it's like, this is a business. A lot of times people make decisions and make moves, and it really has nothing to do with you. It may feel very personal because your heart, your soul, everything is in it.
Yeah.
But a lot of times it's just not personal.
Yeah.
And you just got to move on. And I think that builds strength with maneuvering in this industry is
for
when
sure.
You're not able to take anything personal and just understanding it's just how things goes
yeah.
sometimes.
And a lot of times people have stuff going on themselves that they don't even have the capacity to be thinking about doing something personal. So that definitely is true.
Yeah.
Definitely is true. And I realized that when I was saying that earlier about saying no, I was saying the don't be afraid to say yes one. So what I said earlier was that one. And yeah, so.
Okay. Well, those are some of our do's and don'ts of the industry. And we just want to say thank you so much.
Thanks.
Thanks so much for having us, everybody.
Give it up for Ms. Case Carter and Ms. Mikey McClarron, everybody. Thank y'all. A lot of really good tips up there. I think the biggest takeaway, right, is just be yourself. We're not trying to be anything but ourselves. We're in a creative field, right? And the only creative person that you can be is your own creative person, right? Don't try and be like somebody else. Be genuine. Be thoughtful. I think the other thing to remember is that, you know, this industry that we're in is a living industry, right? It's constantly living and recreating and re-identifying and remaking itself. And so, you know, if there's something that, you know, that you don't like about the industry, change it. Do it differently in your way, you know? Make it your own. Do things the way that you feel that they should be done. I mean, be respectful about it, you know. Don't be that person, you know. But make the changes that you need to make. We just came out of a really hard 2.5 years, right? And we all have to know how to pivot and how to change, right? So if you want to do something different, make that happen. Up next, everybody. Where are they? There they go. Okay. Next up, let me please introduce Seven Spillios and Andrew Joslyn. They've been working together for a long time, so they got some really fun stuff to talk about. Welcome, everybody.
Hello, hello. How's everyone doing? Sweet. My name is Andrew Joslyn, and this is Seven. We're really excited to be here today to talk about the Seattle Freeze.
Wait, what?
No, I'm sorry. What's the topic? I guess, you know, first things first, we don't have a showy presentation for y'all. We just wanted to kind of break it down and just be human with you and talk about kind of our experience coming to Seattle, what it means to be a part of this community, what to give, you know, giving back to the community, and how to better kind of present yourself and build a career in this industry, which we all know is kind of tumultuous and because of the pandemic is that much harder to kind of make your path into. So you want to introduce yourself too?
Yeah, let's start with some introductions. So Seven is the name. You can call me Seven Sky, if that's a little easier to remember than Seven Spillios. I'm a composer, arranger. We're both directors for the Seattle Composers Alliance. What else do we do? I'm a saxophonist, playing a lot of bands, a session musician. And I feel like Andrew, as well as I, we both cover a lot of ground as far as the roles that we cover in the scene. I feel like no matter how good of a performer you are, it's very difficult to be a full-time performer. Especially if you're like me and you just moved into the scene only a few years ago, you don't know that many people. Andrew, what do you do?
I'm so sorry. I totally forgot to share that. So as Seven was saying, like I've had to wear many, many hats since essentially becoming a full-time musician. So I started off playing violin at the age of 5, and then always was the kid that really, really wanted to be in the music industry, however, whatever that would look like. But, you know, my background and how it first was presented to me, you know, in classical, you're essentially either a performer, you're in the orchestra, or you're a music teacher. Both those options didn't really seem that appealing to me. So for the longest time, I really wanted to figure out, well, what does it mean for me to be in the industry? How do I create a path that feels rewarding and also kind of feels like it's, I don't know, that I can actually be a part of the community? So that kind of led me down a lot of different paths. I joined a folk punk rock band for a minute, became a tour manager. I was an A&R manager for a number of years with a local record label here in town called Votive. I currently do talent booking over in Kitsap. I'm a creative director for Seattle Symphony. I do a lot of film scoring and a bunch of other stuff. So kind of as we were saying, and you know how they had in their previous presentation, you kind of have to, unfortunately nowadays with this industry, you do have to wear a lot of different hats. And I think one of the most important things to keep in mind is once you first take your first paycheck as an artist, you are a small business. And the faster that you can start treating yourself professionally and in the light that you are a business, and I don't mean to denigrate what it means to be an artist and what true art means, but the faster that you can realize that at that moment there is a transactional nature to the work that you do and treat it with the due respect, you set yourself up for actually professionally approaching what it means to be a music professional and actually set yourself up for success. So, and we'll get more into that and stuff, but I want that to be something that resonates with you guys, that it's really important to treat this with the honor and the respect that it's due. You know, like, one of my favorite quotes, I think it was, I can't remember the name of the artist, but he was a famous trumpet player, and it's just totally eluding me, but he always showed up to a gig full suited, ready to go, sheet music in hand. He knew the charts. He was ready. And everyone's like, man, you're always like, you look so dapper. Like, what is this? And he's like, I treat it like a job, man. But it's because I love it and I respect it. And I show up and I make sure that people know that. And that's first impression goes the distance. And that's why he kept on getting hired over and over and over. So I'm rambling, but let's, yeah.
Yeah, well, I can kind of speak to that as well. I mean, when you're treating your art like a business, you know, things like Casey and Mikey were covering earlier, like don't take things personally, that is kind of a business mindset. Is, you know, sometimes you might apply for something and to that person's business, you might not be the right fit. And it's not you personally, it's the business relationship, right? And when you're thinking of yourself as a business, that also changes the way you think about valuing your time, which is huge. It's like you don't want to undervalue your art and the things that you do for the community. And so if you're thinking of yourself as a small business, then you're going to make kind of better decisions as to how other people see you as being an artist and a business, and your time is valuable. It's kind of the short short answer to that.
Well, we have a bit of a structure to this, and I think maybe one thing we'll kind of dive into is, so Seven and I, like how we actually met, right as the pandemic was hitting, I was a judge for Sound Off, and he was one of the contenders. So it was kind of serendipitous, you know, we want to talk about kind of networking and kind of getting into the community and stuff, and we wanted to use kind of our relationship as a model for, you kind of, there's a serendipitous kind of thing that happens. Sometimes you just don't know when you're going to meet a connection that's going to mean something to your business, to your network, to your future art. So, you know, there was a lot of different performers on Sound Off. It was rad. We never got to get to the very, very end of that competition because, well, lo and behold, a global pandemic struck, you know, a zombie ice age apocalypse, and we were not able to kind of finish out that programming. However, Seven and I connected because I really appreciated the focus and the integrity he had with his art. At the moment when I first saw him perform, it wasn't a, oh, what is this going to do for me? What's the mercenary aspect of like, oh, I need to network with this guy. He just seemed like someone cool that I was like, hey, maybe this might be a good connection to just kind of chat about music or what some cool records are. So that was kind of like our initial kind of introduction, but, you know.
Yeah, it was actually interesting because like there were three other Sound Off judges, and when they were giving their introductions to all of us performers, Andrew stuck out to me as like, oh, he does film scoring and he does like touring and he's a full-time musician, and I saw him as somebody that I wanted to, you know, I wanted to take steps to become closer to him in some ways. And so I was like, well, I got to know this guy. I got to go up. I got to say hi. I got to see how I can be friends at least with this guy, or at least make this guy know that I exist and I'm inspired by what he's doing. So, from my perspective, I think it's really important to find, seek, connect with people that are doing what you want to do. And there's kind of a saying in the performance world of like, you know, you should be the quote unquote, like, how do they say it? Like, you should be the worst person in your band, right? Everyone you're in your band with, you should be looking up to them as, wow, I have so much to learn from this person, and this person's stage presence is awesome, right? So So I feel like that's really important in a mentor-mentee relationship, of course. And
well,
I feel like you have more of that.
Yeah, and I mean, that was something that's really important for me. So I do a lot of service work with the local community. So I'm a Seattle Music Commissioner. I'm the board with this organization called SMASH, which is Seattle Musicians Access to Sustainable Healthcare. I'm also a co-chair of National Advocacy for the Recording Academy. And one of the most important things that's it comes back to me over and over and over again is that you have to continually put back into your local community. No matter what, no matter what level of success you're at, you always need to pay homage and make sure that you are helping the scene, both industry-wide in terms of the business, the infrastructure, you know, and what, you know, and a great example of that would be if you're a band leader, make sure that you're paying equitably and fair prices for your bandmates, you know. If you can't afford it or there's a show, like, there's ways that you need to continually make sure that you're protecting and sustaining this industry. You know, one of the hardest things is, it's hard enough for music and musicians to kind of make their way, but when you're working with the general public, the vast majority of people don't understand what we do, how we make money, how the revenue works, none of it. So I feel like a lot of our work as musicians is educating the general public on what it means to be a musician and what it means to actually be treated with the respect, you know, as small businesses. So where am I going with this? The bottom line is if you treat your own community with the respect that it's due. So like for me with Scott, or yeah, with Seven, I wanted to make sure that I was giving opportunities and working on creating community in the way that he could have success and can, you know, where am I going with this?
Well, I mean, it's a partnership, right?
Yeah.
And I mean, there's something that happens to crazy busy people like Andrew who do a million things is that they get too busy to take on new things and to do all the things that they want to do. So that should actually tie us into like how we actually work together.
Yeah.
And why it's us two on stage and not me and Ben or something.
Right. Yeah. Do you want to come back? So with a lot of work that I do with symphonies and stuff. So for example, with the Essential Series with Seattle Symphony, there's a lot of prep work that goes into creating full scores for, you know, 80-piece orchestra. So when Seven and I first connected, finding out that he had a skill set in doing transcribing and was really familiar with, like, Sibelius, which is a music program for notation, it was one of those things for me where I was like, this is a skill set that I could really... I do a lot of that work myself, but having someone that I can essentially delegate those tasks to in terms of just like, hey, let's get your skill set up. Let's get you to a point where you can actually like start taking on maybe some orchestration work. So it's another way of kind of paying back to the community in terms of creating opportunities for other people to help them get to a spot of success. So that's one way that for Seven and I that we relate where I try and get him, you know, here's a bunch of symphony scores that I need you to kind of just essentially like, what's the chord progression? What's just like, get stuff prepped so it's ready for me to start doing full symphony arranging. So.
Yeah, and it really shows that time is the most valuable resource for any of us, but especially in the creative scene where you want to have the time to, you know, get your performance on your instrument to a professional level. You want to get to the point where you're scoring films professionally or whatever you want to be doing artistically. It all takes time. And so for somebody like Andrew who is able to delegate some of the like logistical tasks to me, that gives him more that gives him more freedom to do some of the more like creative things. And it's just you know, it's a partnership that goes both ways, right?
Yeah.
Yeah. We should talk about... this is why we have notes.
This is why we have notes.
Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah.
This is why we should have had a slideshow.
No.
Okay. Yeah.
Yeah, you want to start?
I was just going to say just the way it's going to network.
Yeah, let's do that. Because that's what we're about to get into is live networking. And that's, I think, probably the number one thing in the industry is just meeting new people and getting to know other people and seeing how you can build your own community and build your own teams.
Right. Yeah, and I think, you know, one thing that's a lot of really good things was kind of presented in the last presentation, and just to kind of reiterate some of those points but kind of put our own spin on them. You know, with kind of networking and getting a foothold in the industry, regardless if you're here in Seattle or anywhere, it's really important to, as we kind of harped on a number of times, it's about really kind of giving back to the scene. I think one of my favorite quotes that I've heard recently was, if we're really, really honest about greed and what it means in the world, and we broke everything down into greed, there's only two types. There's long-term and there's short-term greed. And short-term, it's maybe it's a quick payoff, it's immediate gratification, but there's always there's pitfalls, and there's always someone that's going to be damaged in the process if you look at it transactionally. But if you look at it in long term of really, really giving back and really creating something that's long lasting and sustainable, and if you conduct yourself in a way where everything's long term greed, I think in essence you see the value of the community as a whole. And I, you know, For me, I try and conduct myself when I'm working in the music industry to avoid cannibalistic and kind of self-serving mercenary attitudes, you know? One of the things that's really important that I see that a lot of bands need to work on is if you overplay the scene, for example, if you're at a certain tier as a performing artist and you play and oversaturate your market, like if you're playing every week, you're taking gigs from other musicians in the area. You are making sure that, you know, in a way, you're damaging the scene, if that makes sense. So, again, if you look at how your impact is locally, you are ultimately helping the whole scene kind of become a better version of itself, I guess is the best way to put it.
Yeah, when it comes to like building community and building the scene, I think a good example is, you know, to talk about another thing that I do is I manage an artist, and at the time, this was probably about 6 to 9 months ago, we were looking for him to perform, but we didn't have a huge draw, and all the venues were kind of getting booked up at the time, so we thought, hey, let's find this little diner kind of dive bar area and let's have a show here. You know, this place isn't known for hosting music, but let's do it. And then after that, I got in touch with the venue owner and was just like, hey, if we did this once for this artist, why don't we just keep this going on a semi-monthly basis and create a new venue for people to play music at, for local Greenwood residents to stop by and see some music, right? It's always, you're always trying to find ways to build community that, and they should always be a, you know, win for the audience in that case, yeah. Win for the performers, win for me to meet new people at the very least, and a win for the venue owner to have some more traction at his business and get more drinks and food sold, right? That's a really good way to build your community, is to create a new event or maybe a new event space.
Yeah, I think that's one thing that's important, and that's a great example. You know, a lot of people, as I was saying, from like, you don't want to be overly mercenary where you're just keep on asking for the community to provide you with money, to provide you with the ability to sustain yourself. One of the best ways that I've been able to network with the music community and be able to get, to be able to like do more work and stuff is by creating opportunities. You know, if I have a film scoring gig, making sure that I can get a bunch of, you know, making sure that I can find a project that has the budget where I can hire a bunch of musicians to play, you know. And that's a great way to network, give back to the community, but also be able to create even better projects and better products in the end. So, you know, just talking about being a booker, or if you're struggling to get a foothold in the city, or like you're just trying to figure out where your place is, create an opportunity and be like, hey, I have this cool project. You know, I want to put on some festival, or I want to put on a show or whatever. Reach out to the community and try and bring in people that way, you know, as opposed to being like, well, what can you do for me? What can, you know, hey, I want to be hired. Me. If you look at it as another way, like, hey, I want to provide, it's a different way of approaching the same work. So,
yeah, well said.
Yeah.
So one of the really cool things about this first roadshow is that we're about to get into the networking aspect, where you're basically going to have the opportunity to meet with us, meet with the mentors at the tables, and this is a perfect chance for you to ask us about, you know, whatever you want to ask us about, and also, you know, get contacts from other people that are here. Everyone who's sitting in these chairs, you are all obviously people that want to succeed in the music or creative arts industry, no matter what that might be. And yeah, get each other's numbers. See how you can build the community. It's kind of the point.
Yeah. Well, thank you guys so much in sending through our short little presentation. Yeah, if you guys have any questions, concerns, comments, we're available to chat after this. And yeah, thank you guys so much for having us.
Give it up for Andrew Joslyn and Seven Spillios, everybody. You know, this first road show is kind of an overview. The music industry, really the creative industry, is a behemoth. It's huge. It incorporates a lot of different things, whether that's production or marketing, PR, not to mention performance, right? There's just so many things that encapsulate what it is that we do, and it was really great for them to talk about the fact that so many of us have to wear so many hats to engage in this business. One way to wear less hats is to collaborate, right? And, you know, right? We get that? I just want to see that we understand what that means right here, okay? So we're going to sneak into our next section, which is our speed mentoring. And also, you know, earlier I had all the commissioners raise their hands. So in lieu of like a, you know, a traditional Q&A, we thought it would be much better coming out of this pandemic if you just kind of walked up to some folks and started talking to them, right? Like you would at a bus stop, say. And maybe that's just me. So, you know, we're going to get up, spread our legs. We're going to have all of our mentors over here on this side. This is speed mentoring, okay? So let's be cognizant. What'd you say? Oh yeah, no. I was just waiting for the slide to pop up. Don't worry, I got this. We're all here. We're good. So we're gonna do some speed mentoring over here. But before I do that, I just want to bring attention to the board over here. We have put together some takeaway resources for you. This is a living document. So we're gonna be constantly adding new things and new links and new components to this as the year progresses and as we add more road shows and more things, right? So please QR code this right now. That's right, take out all your phones, your smart stuff. Click it, snap it, take it, get it, drop it. What you doing, man, talking about it. Get it on it. And keep it open, you know? Look at it, use it. A lot of the stuff that our speakers were talking about are things that you're going to find in this resource packet, and you know, save it or something so that you can come back to it. Our next slide, we got Foundry 10 and Vera Project. They're going to do this digital audio production workshop. So scan that. That's going to be hosted at the Vera Project. This is obviously a big deal, right? For a lot of us creatives that, you know, maybe we're solely performers or maybe even just event producers, knowing how to, like, make our own tracks and edit and put them together is a big deal. So please take advantage of that. And that, again, Vera Project is just literally a hop, skip, and a jump. In fact, probably after this, maybe you should take a little walk. It's a nice day. It's not raining like I said it was gonna. So, you know, take a little spin. Next track, please. And pre-register for the next roadshow. As I mentioned, this particular roadshow was more or less a broad overview of the juggernaut that is the music industry. It's huge. It's nonstop. It keeps going. The next roadshow, we'll be kind of breaking it down into smaller component parts and focusing on individual aspects of this industry so that we can kind of get honed in on that. So as I mentioned before, we're gonna move into our speed mentoring over here, and I was about to get into what speed meant. You know what I'm saying? Let's not take up the time. Let's not mercenary this issue like Angie was talking about. Have some questions, ask them, and let's allow other people to get into that. I'm on it. I'm circuitous in my delivery, but I get there. So. Who are you going to be talking to, and what are they about? Well, Jovino Santos is a brilliant composer, musician, and educator. If you want to learn about some chord progressions, maybe. I mean, maybe not. I don't know. If you know what that is, he'd be the person to talk to. Mira Kraft is. Can Mira raise her hand right there? They're gonna be they're in the PR marketing business and event basically music business. They're in the business of music, and so they're gonna have a lot of really wonderful things to talk about in terms of just understanding how this whole thing works, how to promote yourself, how to engage in this business beyond the performance, right? Let's see, where is Shaina at? There's Shaina right there. Shaina is event producer. Much of what was talked about here is like, how do we create new events? How do we DIY this ourselves? How are we hosting events? How are we creating these things so that we can turn maybe non-traditional spaces into spaces, right? That we can perform or do stuff, right? How can we get creative with this? You know what I'm saying? That's gonna be the person you're gonna wanna talk to there. And Trey Holiday right there, raise your hand right there. Y'all might know Trey from the TVs, from the internets and the videos. She's a media personality and also knows a lot about event production as well. And so we're gonna get a nice little panoply of the breadth and scope of what this industry is. So please think of some nice questions, thoughtful questions. Get in there, and then get out, and then find somebody else to talk to. In fact, you could probably turn to your left. And then turn to your right, and you probably meet somebody right there. You can thank me later. Break. Oh, yeah, that's it. Break. That's it. Oh, what? Oh, sorry. There's a lot going on in my life right now. Okay. We're also gonna do a little live stream Q&A situation up here. Yours truly. We'll be up here, so people can ask some questions, and we'll answer them. So stick around. Also, there's a Billie Eilish concert going on. Maybe you guys got tickets. Don't go there yet. Don't even think about it. Stay in this building for the next hour or so. All right? I think that's it. Peace. I also want to Real quick, I know you are doing exactly what I told you to do, which I'm really appreciative of. Like, y'all are asking questions, you're talking to people. But I also want you to know that in about a half hour, maybe 40 minutes, we're going to have a performance from Seattle's own Gavon Leo. So please stick around for that. He was a performer for Sound Off over here at Mopop, and we're really fortunate to have him perform for y'all. So stick around for that. Thank you.
Out on the nightlife. passion, more excitement, more everything.
KEXP, Seattle.
Let me tell you something, yeah? Yeah.com wine.
I'm all these people, you know it's movie star Johnny, UK dancer general. And right now, me are going to introduce a song. We are going to take over the world, please. We are going to run the dance floor. FKA Twigs, Shy Girl, play this song. See this song, yeah?
Let me tell you something, yeah? Yeah.com wine, or Yeah.com dance. And I'm just meaning like, she just lets herself be free and is so expressive and just don't give a f. Oh, there's nothing more sexier than that.
Truth say, I've never realized. Got the Capri Sun energy, yeah. Where's the grind up on in your area? Let's start it again. Boom, boom, take us when you can't find the wind up. But everybody wants to stand up for my love. Sticky sweet, I'm gonna be like a killer.
I'm doing all right. How you doing?
You are doing all right.
Natalie, was it? If you do the QR code, that'll keep you in touch with everything that you need to know. We're trying to go paperless these days, you know what I mean? We're good? All right.
Hello, hello.
We might just be live stream. Oh, we are live stream.
Are we?
Oh. Oh, yeah. Oh, hey.
Yes, we sure are. Hello, everyone. My name is Raina Mathis. I am I work at Northwest Folklife with Ben as well. I'm also the magazine editor for Earshot Jazz, and so that's sort of a little bit my background. And we're just going to do a little bit of a Q&A live stream for the next 30 minutes or so. So feel free to drop your questions in the YouTube chat, and we'll be able to read them. And yeah, so Ben, can you just start by saying a little bit about yourself? And because I'm also a youth educator at heart, I need an icebreaker, okay?
Okay.
So, tell me something that has fed your soul lately.
Something that has fed my soul lately.
Mm-hmm.
Well, I mean, that's easy, I guess. I had a baby 2 years ago, and he feeds my soul constantly, good and bad, frustrating and not. He started pooping everywhere, not in the diaper. So that's fed a certain type of soul. But no, I mean, I think, you know, as an educator myself, it's important to think about how we interact with our kids and our young people, and I certainly hope that he embodies something musical in his life. But just watching him grow and how he learns certainly feeds my soul, and as an educator feeds how I think about continuing education on a much more personal level.
Absolutely, yeah. Thank you for sharing that. That actually may lead well into our first question for you.
All right.
How do young artists, teens or youth artists specifically, find opportunities in this industry? And are there any orgs that you would recommend folks connecting with?
Absolutely. And I mean, I just have to mention, right, that, like, you know, I'm 36 or whatever, and I'm from Phoenix. And when I was this age, similar to Andrew Joslyn, you know, I started playing the violin when I was 5. And so there wasn't as many opportunities for me outside of classical music to study or to, like, get involved with stuff. I'm really happy that Hey, y'all, ladies, ladies, we're doing a live stream. If you can just, scoot over just a second, that's okay. No, 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 it's okay. No, it's all right. Oh, you're fine.
Good.
I just want to make sure people can see this, see what's going on here. You know, that's all.
See the matching fits. See the matching fits.
Y'all don't see the matching.
If you don't
track
see
suits right here.
Okay, sorry. Continue.
But in all seriousness, Seattle, there's an abundance of opportunities for young people to get involved in music. Off the top of my head, and perhaps a little bit selfishly, there's the Rap City Project, which I co-founded a number of years ago, which explores Americana and American roots music, blues, folk, early jazz. You have Jazz Ed, which is an incredible organization that's been around for, I'd say, 12 or 13 years now, which is exactly what it is. It's a jazz education organization. We have Totem Star that's represented here at this event tonight, and they offer opportunities for young people to get into a studio and learn how to do production and make their own beats and make their own music and perform. We have Sound Off at Mopop, which is an opportunity for young people to perform and showcase their work. You know, so there's a lot of opportunities available, and I guess I really just encourage young people in general, you know, with the advent of internet, and I know I sound really old when I say that, but with the advent of the internet, you know, there's a whole bunch of opportunities to learn how to perfect your craft, how to get into new aspects of music. You know, even myself during the pandemic, you know, I wanted to do a deeper dive into playing guitar and study different guitar styles from West Africa and Brazil. And, you know, there's YouTube channels that you can get into and that you can find. So there's not a lack of opportunities. But, you know, sometimes it just means opening your eyes to some of the internet options. But certainly the four organizations that I mentioned, you know, if you start there, that'll kick off a whole bunch of opportunities. And two of those organizations, Totem Star and Rhapsody, are actually in the process of occupying King Street Station and having a full, you know, big studio production area that is going to be a huge asset for young people in this city to be able to take advantage of.
Thank you for sharing some of those opportunities for young folks. I want to speak a little bit to, and in your beautiful introduction of yourself, as a multi-hyphenate artist, can you speak to maybe a myth that might exist about when you take control of your career as an independent artist, and it means that you have to develop skills that are just completely out of your creative wheelhouse, you know, production, marketing, like, can you speak to some of that, and does it feel a little true, or what's the reality there?
Much of what has been mentioned today is like people needing to wear many hats, and that's true. Also, what has been mentioned today is the value of networking and collaboration. And so, you know, I think, you know, there's the saying, jack of all trades, master of none. You know, don't spread yourself so thin that you feel like you have to do everything to make your business work. You know, the idea that, you know, you pick up yourself by the bootstraps and you build up yourself all by yourself really is never how it ever happens. You know, you can watch the Kanye West story on Netflix and think that he did it all by himself, but you can see it, and he didn't. You know, he relied on a whole bunch of people to help him get to where he was. And that goes for all spectrums and all strands of the music industry. You know, make friends, connect with people. Just yesterday, I was recording an artist who was like, you know, I was trying to get into production so I could make my own beats, but I realized that's not what I wanted to do. I wanted to write, I wanted to make poetry, and I needed to find somebody that I could collaborate with to produce these beats that I gelled with. And so it's about relationships. And I think if that can be the center of how you engage with the creative industry, is about creating relationships, and really that applies to the world, then you're set, you know. And it's not only will you live in a place that you can produce good music or good art, but you'll also maintain a passion and a love with it that doesn't overwork you or burden you or make you turn against the stuff that you're doing.
Right. Yeah. And I've been really loving the, and we've mentioned this a couple times too, but there is community, and that's important. And there's also, you know, recognizing this industry as an ecosystem too.
Exactly.
And we are all contributing to this. We all have our place. We all have our skills, and no one is undeserving of being in this space as well. And I've personally struggled with that too, you know, not being an artist, but in the industry, and a lot of like imposter syndrome around that too.
Exactly.
Yeah. Well, thank you, Ben.
Thank you so much, Raina.
To our next guest.
Stay tuned. Up next is Kitty Woo.
Kitty Woo. Yeah, thank you. Kitty Woo. Kitty Woo, can I have you on stage, please? Hello, hello. Thank you. You're in the hot seat. Okay.
We got a little, there's some really great conversations happening here, so.
Yeah, did I steal you away from the mentoring?
You did, but it's okay.
All right, I'm fine with that. Oh, we do? I don't see it. Can you read it?
What mentality or tools should an artist have regarding rejection and roadblocks?
Oh, can I read that here? All right, I have a first question for you, Kitty,
okay,
that I'm reading off of our live chat. This is from Anna. What mentality / tools should an artist have regarding rejection and roadblocks? Before you go ahead and answer that, can you say a little bit about who you are?
Yeah.
Thank you.
My name is Kitty Woo, and I am co-director over at 206 Zulu, and I am chair of the Music Commission of the City of Seattle.
Sure are.
And wear a ton of different hats.
Yeah.
Yeah. And then the question was, what mentality?
What mentality / tools? And I'm sorry, the chat isn't showing up on my...
As a new artist. Boom. What mentality and tools as a new artist?
Should an artist have regarding rejection and roadblocks?
Oh, rejection and Well, if they watched earlier, Casey really put it into a good perspective about being able to pivot. Because you are going to say no. You're going to hear no a lot.
Right.
You're going to hear some maybes, and maybe every once in a while you'll hear a yes, especially early on. So I would just say being open and flexible, and being part of a networking event like this, asking these kind of questions, I think the most important thing is being open and ready to pivot if needed.
Right. That is a big part of this work. Do you feel like you need a manager or specific lawyers? That's come up in some of the questions and people, you know, wanting to navigate this industry correctly and all the semantics around it, you know?
I think eventually you will need a manager, but I think early on, you are your manager. Like,
right,
you are your agent. You are your tour manager. And I think people get a little lost in, like, the things that they don't have. When really you need to be able to wear many, many hats and ask a lot of questions and do that stuff yourself, especially in the beginning. I mean, there's a lot of artists that are, you know, a decade, 20 years in that still are their own tour manager, that still are their own manager. So I think in these days you can do it however which way you want.
Right, that's a choice.
Yeah,
for sure. When do you feel like if you want to move towards having a manager, when do you feel like that is you're ready for that?
I think when things become unmanageable yourself, like when you're getting so many offers that you're letting things drop through the cracks, that's when, and I think really that's when people will start asking you, like, do you have management? Do you need help? And a lot of times having, in those early years, having your friends and your, you know, like your loved ones handle some of that stuff for you is really valuable.
Absolutely, yeah. Community is everything in this. A little bit more about some of the logistics, admin-y of this work too. And this came from a question earlier. How can folks get financial help to pursue their goals in the industry?
Well, first and foremost, a lot of people have jobs, like day jobs. As they're going into, like, as creatives as a whole, like whether you're a musician or a visual artist or a photographer, a lot of people, and like even the first person that came to mind was Macklemore. He had a job for many of those years, but in the early years, and I think that's just kind of maybe a necessity.
Yeah.
But what was the question again?
Oh, how do folks get financial help pursue their goals?
Yeah, so then there's also, you know, I sit on the Music Commission, and there is this really great, if you saw earlier, Royal Alley Barnes, she is the director, the interim director of the arts Office of Arts and Culture. Mm-hmm. There's also For Culture. There's a Seattle Foundation. There's a lot of different places where you can get early grants that, you know, starting from a small point. I remember one of our first grants was a $500 grant. You do the thing, you invite the public. There has to be a public benefit, so something has to be free, or, you know, you're providing some kind of service to the public, and then you get reimbursed. So a lot of these are reimbursement grants, but I would say start. An easy one is For Culture, forculture.org. Yes. The website is really great. It's an easy tool to use. I would say get on there and look. Actually, I think there's a couple artist grants coming up like this
month.
And
it's like rolling basis. Like they are constantly putting out opportunities for artists and creative and cultural, you know, folks to get funding. Absolutely. That's a great word. Thank you for sharing that. We have to move on to our next person soon, but... I would love just like closing thoughts, advice that you would share with our audience.
Gosh, that's a good one. I mean, I really am just going back to Casey's do's and don'ts. Yeah. And really the thing that struck me was the very first one is be kind to everyone, whether or not they can do something for you. Yeah. Because people, we do talk, like we're a very small industry here in Seattle. We all do talk. And if you're out there just being a jerk, it's not going to work out for you. It might work out for a little bit, but people don't like to work with jerks.
Yeah. And we want to help each other, too. We are all moving towards the same thing, you know? Mm-hmm. Like, I want to help you. I want to be your friend. Like, help me be your friend.
Yeah, let's do it.
Yes. So thank you.
Thank you so much.
Thank you, Katie.
All
right, I appreciate
who am I grabbing?
It. Who do we have next? Oh, we have Jovino Santos Neto. Jovino. We are waiting for Jovino to get to the stage. Hi, Jovino.
Hey,
Raina. Hello. Grab a seat.
Hello.
You're my last guest of this little Q&A.
But not the least.
But, I mean, I'm not choosing favorites, but.
Hello.
Can you tell the people a little bit about who you are? Mm-hmm. Our camera's right there.
My name is Jovino Santos Neto. I'm a pianist, composer. I was born in Rio de Janeiro, Brazil, many years ago. And for the past 29 years, I'm living in Seattle. I love it here. This became my second hometown. And I love playing music. Music is what brought me here, and music is what keeps me here. So I love to create. It's a good place to create, but I don't think of myself as a Seattle artist. I am a Seattle artist. I'm very proud of that. But what I like to do is think of music, because the essence of music, it's in invisibility. And since it's a vibration that you can send anywhere in the world, I love, you know, it's a funny trivia fact. I got more followers in Nepal than I do in Seattle. And I've never been to Nepal. So I love that. For some reason, they found me on Facebook or whatever. And so I have Bangladesh is actually another one
so
place.
So now you need to go to Nepal.
Yeah, I got
to
go
to
Bangladesh and Nepal, because I have fans there who I never met. But for some reason, they still like my page.
But they connect with your music.
Exactly.
Right.
So the vibration of the music, thanks to technology, but even before the internet and YouTube and all those things, music was already the internet. Mm. So whenever you played music, like when Bach played music in the 1700s in Germany, the vibration of what he played got to Greece or got to Italy or got to Africa. And so the music has a character. It's like if you in the water, if you throw a pebble, it makes those ripples. And the ripples keep going until... they ran out of mass. They ran out of energy. The music, the energy of music keeps going. Mm-hmm. So it's beyond what you can physically hear.
I love hearing you talk about music. it's so wholesome. I appreciate you so much. As a not Seattle artists, but you are here making music. And you know, you're talking about your other international followings. How do you branch out into other cities, or what tips do you have around doing such? What are some marketing tactics that might help improve one's reach?
One thing that I like, for instance, I'm a fan of languages, all languages. And I want to learn all the languages of the world. There's probably not enough time for me to do that. But for me, I have a fascination with how human beings communicate verbally and also with a body language, you know, how Italians, you know, that kind of thing, and how people, you know, do certain gestures. I also am a fan of food. I love to eat. Not eat a lot, but I love to eat different things. So for me, music falls into that same category. I'm like a, what do you call, an omnivorous opportunist.
Oh, I like this term.
The same way that I like all these different kinds of cuisine from around the world and to sample, for the simple reason that I haven't tried it yet. Mm-hmm. I'm curious, oh, maybe I don't like it. But it's very rare for me to find something I don't like. I say, maybe not now.
Yeah.
I'll leave that burrito for later. But in any case, that kind of a voracity,
hunger?
Appetite.
Yes.
So that for me is music too. So that has led me to collaborate with musicians from Mali, from India, from China, from the United States, from Europe, from Brazil, where I'm from. So I am proud to be a polyglot, musically speaking, because I can communicate with a symphony orchestra, and I can communicate with a bunch of drummers jumping around a circle and beating drums around the fire. So that, for me, they hold the same kind of a curiosity that I want to play. Sometimes it's not that I want to be good at all of those things, but if I can stand behind in a Cuban, rumba, and I just clap the clave, well, everybody else is doing, like, I'm already part of that vibe.
Yeah.
So
you're already communicating.
I know. Maybe take a little shaker, a little egg shaker, and that's your participation on that music. But for me, it's like my way of sampling the flavors. We don't have adjectives to describe music unless they're visual, right? But at least I like to say the flavors. So this music can be a little spicier, a little saltier, a little sweet, a little mellow, a little gooey, a little crunchy. Mm-hmm. Textures.
Textures of the music. Thank you. Okay, great. Thank you. This is a question that I feel like will always exist, especially in a city like Seattle that is so expensive. But how do you balance the cost of living with rising as an artist? And how do you balance
great
work
question.
And art and health? Health.
Well, I think that we are, in that sense, we are hunter-gatherers. With human beings, were hunter-gatherers for a lot longer before they became agricultural people who had to plow and seed and harvest from the same plot of land. So before, you went around until you found, you know, a herd of mammoths or maybe a deer or maybe an elk, something you needed to dinner, right? So dinner was important for survival. So I think that in a way I consider myself to be a nomadic hunter-gatherer as a musician, because there's something in me which is very nomadic in itself. I descend from people who are navigators, who went around the world, not just Portuguese, but I have all kinds of DNA. My DNA is like a big mixed salad of every kind of thing, from Togo to the Middle East to Iberian Peninsula to native Brazilian. Anyway, I love it. And because of that, by feeling at home and having this urge, dynamic urge to go out and find other places, that led me to planting seeds in different places. So I live in Seattle, and we're always dealing with things that are so crazy. I mean, as you said, I pay rent, okay, in my apartment, and the rent has jumped up like a whole bunch. I go, holy, you know, it's like, how are we going to do this? But at the same time, if you are good at planting those seeds, and music is like messages in a bottle. I did a round of emails around the world looking for work for next year. I sent about 300. I got one answer that said no. So, but anyway, so you feel a little, oh, really? Nobody loves me, you know, I'm abandoned. But that's not the nature of it, because all these people are busy. Anyway, What a pleasure to talk. And we'll talk more. As you know, I could go on. But you find me out there. We can chat more.
Yes. Thank you, Jovino. And thank you to all of the guests who came up today. And continue to network for folks on the side if you were here in person today. Oh, we got one more. We got time?
Mira.
Oh. Okay. It's like one more. Mira Kraft, can you please join me on stage? Oh. Beautiful. Hello, Mira.
Hello.
How has your day been so far?
It's going. How about
yeah,
you?
Yeah, I know. I saw you over there, and you jumped over here. So
talking.
Boop, boop, boop. Okay. Mira, can you tell the people a little bit about yourself, please?
Yeah, so I do brand development and creative strategy, working kind of like behind the scenes in the music world, just work on project management and kind of figuring out what blueprint we want to put together for my clients' goals.
Beautiful. Thank you.
Yeah.
So I have a few questions here.
Okay.
A bunch of people submitted this earlier, so I get to read this. Can you speak on managing fellow artists or starting labels?
Starting labels?
Yes.
Yeah, so I mean, I think coming in as like a manager or a project manager, it's important to like realize that there's always, yes, there's rules to this game that we need to follow, but each artist is like vastly different. And so really figuring out like what hits for them specifically and what is cohesive opportunities for their vibe and their brand. And labels specifically, like I think community is everything, like creating a space where people can kind of like put together a team and really like build off of what everyone else is doing, I think is really important. So if you're looking to start a label, I mean, the first thing that you should be doing is like looking into making sure that you have things to offer. So like building those relationships, making sure that you have like a different team in your back pocket so that when you're looking to like network with artists, you have something to offer them so that you guys can start to work together.
Yes, thank you. Sort of on that, do you have any advice for how to create a pitch for booking agents or managers?
Yeah, so it's important. These are people that are getting like on a good day, 100 emails, on an average day, thousands, right? Everyone is pitching to them. And so I think it's really important to have a short and succinct email that shows, I've done research about you, here's what I'm trying to offer, and here's what we could achieve together. So like an introduction and really just saying like, hey, I'm a big fan of your X platform. I have something I think your listeners would really like that I would love to share with you. It'd be great to partner together on premiere or press or playlisting, whatever it is that you're reaching out for. But it's important to show them that you've done research, right? If you're someone who's receiving hundreds of emails a day, you're gonna have something where you're filtering through like, did this person copy and paste this and send it to 100 people? Are they reaching out to anyone and they're talking to me like I'm a pop, you know, platform, but really I do indie coverage. Like, show that you've done some research and that you're not just like trying to send out a million emails,
right?
Because that will really hurt a relationship if they can tell that you're not putting that time in.
Right. And you're not being genuine too,
right,
in that connection, right?
Right.
You want to make sure like, this is me.
Yeah.
You are seeing me
100%.
Right now.
100%. Yeah. No, exactly.
And that's how you stand out of those 100 emails coming through.
Right.
Because I know I'm scrolling. Ah.
Right. And that people, like you said, people remember that energy. So it's like, if you're not doing something that's true to your brand, like the interaction isn't going, like they might not remember what you said, but they'll remember how they felt walking away from networking with you. So like always being authentic and really picking up on, you know, what you have to offer and what you're looking to partner on is just, it's a good way to build an authentic relationship. At the end of the day, like, this is chess, not checkers. And so if you're looking to build like fast relationships where you're not really looking at the long end of the game, you might get that quick event you did something with, but they're not going to want to do the next thing that might be a lot bigger. So really thinking about when you're building relationships and doing outreach, you're building a relationship. You're not just looking for a quick come up.
Yeah. Thank you. That was beautiful. Thank you. I mean, yes, checkers, not chess.
Chess, not checkers.
Yeah, I'm going to keep that. Any closing thoughts, last, you know, some advice you want to share with folks before we close out? Yeah.
Yeah. Go for what you want, not what you think you can get. Like, just really, like, when you're building your dreams, like, we live in such a DIY world where everyone, like, you can be a business by creating an Instagram, right? So go for what you want. Like, you're building your foundation, and don't be like cocky about it and be like, well, this is what I want, so I get it. But it's like, you're building your dreams. Don't be afraid to and be prepared for it, right? Like, what is that quote? Luck is when preparation and opportunity meet. Mm-hmm. So it's like, go for what you want. Don't limit yourself by what you think is achievable, and put in the work so that what you want is actually like a valid like opportunity that you're ready for.
Yeah, and don't let that imposter syndrome stop you either.
That's big. That's
right?
Huge.
And we all feel it at some point.
For sure.
And it comes up.
For
you know,
sure.
And I think it speaks back to you know this theme we've said a lot today of just in community having the right people around you, who remind you who you are, mm-hmm. remind you why you're doing this work.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah, yeah. No, it's yeah. so important. Yeah. yeah. Imposter syndrome's real. So I think having that balance of like knowing that you are like great and also being humble, like that's a winning combination right there. Mm. Yeah.
Thank you so much,
Thank
Mira.
You.
I appreciate talking to
you. I appreciate you. Thank you.
Yeah. Okay, now we are officially done with this live stream. And I think we are moving to our 4 o'clock performance by Gavon Leo. Gavon.
All right, everybody. Sorry. I hope you guys have been having a really good time. I hope you guys have made some good connections. Hope you guys have learned some tricks and tips. But now, we're gonna have a little bit of a party, a little bit of fun. We're gonna watch some live music. So please, everybody, give your hands up for Gavon Leo. We'll be right back.
Hello, my Seattle party peeps. This is my second show in Seattle. My name is Gavon Leo. Should have started that off. But I performed at Sound Off exactly a month ago from today, so that's a weird coincidence. But this first song is called Letting Me Be.
I wish for your time, but that was too much to ask from you. Promises made, always late if you showed at all. Beginning of the day, you used substance to take pain away. Yeah, you stumble and fall and break down my walls and I crumble. And there were times you make me wonder, do I give another chance? Stay stuck in the past, the pain on my brain, situations you've made. I gave you my heart, you fucking took it. Memories fading of what we used to be. Setting my soul free, letting me be, letting me be, letting me be. I tried to keep us alive, but it takes more than one. Yeah, I didn't want to fall apart, but parting our ways is where happiness stays. I gave you my heart, you fucking took it. Memories fading of what we used to be. Setting my soul free.
Thank you so much. Thank you. Thank you. You know, that song's just about if you're in some toxic relationship, just taking a moment to step back and think things through. Nothing's the end, and just do what you want to do. You know, as people in 2012 once said, YOLO, and I don't know what happened to that saying, but I'm gonna bring it back. So YOLO, do what you want to do with your life. It comes up to you. No one else's decisions shouldn't inflict on what you want. So just pursue your dreams, and YOLO. All right, we got the sad stuff out of the way. These songs have been released on all platforms if you want to check them out, but you know, I'm going to save that for the end. I'll just show you what I'm talking about.
too hot to touch. Tripping up the stairs, pony tangled hair. She better say a prayer. You're my sanctuary. This ain't no ordinary body like the sun. She got a body like summer. Yeah, body like summer, yeah. Body like summer, body like summer. I chased the feeling of love. I ran the race and I've won. She's my angel in disguise, with the devil in her eye. Sweet God, I'm feeling so anxious. She spins around me like a circus. Hypnotized, her touch is electric. Looking at the mirror for different perspectives. Body like summer. Body like summer. Yeah. Body like summer. Body like summer. Body like the summer, babe. Body like the sun. I like the sun. Previous week was the first we met. Swear to God, my heart pounded out of my chest. Got me paralyzed, shocked when you entered the room. I really can't stop daydreaming of you. I told myself what to say in advance. Stepping up a bit closer, I asked you to dance. I said, girl, you got me boiling up, I can't stop staring. You drop dead gorgeous, I'm a fiend when you're moving that. Body like summer. Yeah, body like summer. Yeah. Body like summer, yeah. Body like summer, body like summer. Yeah, body like summer, yeah. Body like summer, body like summer.
That song is to get you prepped up for the summer that's coming. The leaves are starting to bloom, starting to become green. Thank goodness, we just need more sun in this place. Why can't Seattle and like the San Juans would literally be so perfect if it was like California weather. That's the only thing missing here, but everything else, it's so beautiful. Do we have any Frank Sinatra fans out there? Who here knows about the song, who here knows about the song My Way? All right. Hey. All right. Hey. Since you know it, sing along with me. All right.
And now the end is near, and so I face the final curtain. My friend, I'll say it clear, I'll state my case, of which I'm certain.
Louder.
I've lived a life that's full, and I've traveled each and every highway and more, much more than this. I did it my way. Regrets, snap, I've had a few, snap, but then again, snap, too few to mention.
Let's repeat that.
Regrets, I've had a few, but then again, too few to mention.
Let's change the chords.
Regrets, I've had a few,
just a few.
Regrets, yet too few to mention, to mention a regret. Yeah, I've had a few. Regret, too few to mention, to mention.
This next song is called Regret.
Yeah, it's something I relate to. Yeah, people always talking about mistakes, some bad luck and some bad breaks. Nah, don't gotta dress up, you know I confess up. It's something I relate to. I saw her in the mall elevator. Had a mad crush since I was an eighth grader. She said, how about a movie? I got woozy. Said, girl, I'll catch you with you later. Never knew what might have been. I never got to show it to my friends. Thought my whole world was gonna end. Regrets. Yeah, I've had a few. Too few to mention a regret. Yeah, I've had a few regrets. Yeah, too few to mention Yeah, 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 oh. Yeah, 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 oh. Yeah, yeah, mention. Yeah, 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 oh. Cruising around town in my Trans Am. Getting cut off gets me throwing up hands, man. I yelled, are you stupid? You driving like a Q-tip. I think you scratched at my Ray-Bans. I pulled over, I was ready to fight. Walked straight up past the passenger side. He said, only got a few minutes. My wife's having triplets. Man, I had to cut the red light. Hell, I wish I would've known. But that's the thing, cause you never know how someone else's story goes. Oh, oh, regrets. Yeah, I've had a few regrets. Yeah, too few to mention a regret. Yeah, I've had a few regrets. Yeah, too few to mention. Yeah, 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 oh. Yeah, 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 oh. Yeah, 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 mansion to mansion. Yeah, 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 oh. Yeah, 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 oh, oh, oh. Mansion. Love it, lose it, give it, take it. Nothing's really as big as we make it. You ain't gotta miss out, you ain't gotta be stressed out. Love it, lose it, give it, take it. Nothing's really as big as we make it. You ain't gotta miss out, you ain't gotta be stressed out. Yeah, I've had a few regrets. Yeah, too few to mention regrets. Yeah, I've had a few regrets. Yeah, too few to mention. Yeah, 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 oh. Yeah, 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 mansion to mansion.
Thank you, thank you. I went a little against the rules, and I was supposed to play two songs, and then a Q&A, and then a third song. What? Could I do a cover? Whatever, or a Q&A? I don't know. Let's do a little Q&A and I'll do an outro song. Because then the...
You guys, Gavon Leo, what a talent. So as you may have heard, Gavon was part of Sound Off recently. For those who don't know, can you tell us a little bit about Sound Off and what that experience was like?
Absolutely. So Sound Off was until this year, a competition, but now it's a showcase. So I was the first, I got into the first showcase. So Sound Off, the whole Pacific Northwest can audition, and 12 people are selected out of those who audition, and I happen to be one of them, and I performed exactly a month ago today, February 26th. Aww. And so that was my first Seattle show.
Right on. So where are you from again?
I'm from Anacortes, Washington.
Anacortes.
So like an hour and a half north of here.
I'm quite familiar. That's where my sweetie's family is from. Oh, so we'll talk later about, you know, Ghirardelli and all that stuff.
Oh my gosh, yeah.
So Sound Off is for all ages? Like, what's the deal?
Sound Off is for 21 and under. So okay. it's just a showcase to play in front of people, make great connections. Sound Off is a huge opportunity to just network yourself. Jordan over here, who runs it all, great man. I can't thank him enough for everything he's done.
Shout out to Jordan Leonard. Yes. Jordan Leonard at Mo Pop, ladies and gentlemen.
So if you have any questions about Sound Off, he's the man. It isn't until another year, but heck, you can just prep for it. Do what you want to do, have fun.
You got one more for us?
Yeah, what the? I only have a cover.
What the heck?
What the heck? All right. This song is not mine. It's a 60s song called Sealed with a Kiss by Bobby Vinton.
Though we've gotta say goodbye for the summer, and baby, I promise you this, I'll send you all my love every day in a letter sealed with a kiss. Yes, it's gonna be a cold, lonely summer, but I'll fill the emptiness. I'll send you all my dreams every day in a letter sealed with a kiss. I'll see you in the sunlight, I'll hear your voice everywhere, I'll run to tenderly hold you, but baby, you won't be there. I don't wanna say goodbye for the summer, knowing the love we'll miss. So let us make a pledge to meet in September and seal it with a kiss.
Gavon Leo, where can they find you, Gavon?
You can find me on Instagram. You can also meet me on my merch stand back there, right behind our sound. Thank you so much seriously, Brandon, thank you so much. This is awesome. Thank you, everyone. But you can meet me at my merch table. There's a condition. So at Gavon Leo, G-A-V-O-N. L-E-O. My mom had to be different instead of just G-A-V-I-N, but I like it. It's different.
Get your gav on.
Yeah. So basically you pronounce it as if it was like G-A-V-N. It's like Gavon.
Gavon.
Gavon. So, yeah, just like that.
Don't you forget it.
And you, if you want a free sticker, you have to follow my Instagram. That's the only requirement.
That's the rule.
Yeah, so if you like doing water bottle stickers and stuff, yeah, just do that, show me proof, and I'll give you a free sticker.
Right on. Well, thank you so much, Gavon.
Thank you all so much for coming here tonight.
What a way to close us out. We are so grateful once again that you came and spent some time with us today. Make sure that if you are interested in that film-focused roadshow, it's going to be happening on Saturday, April 30th, most likely at the Uptown Theater over here in Lower Queen Anne. Details are still being confirmed, so, you know, bear with us. Thank you again to KEXP, Jerk Shack, GZ Radio. The live stream was so beautiful, is so beautiful. Thank you to our mentors and our speakers. Make sure you're following them on Instagram or whatever platform you like. And make sure you also check out what's going on with the Office of Arts and Culture, the Office of Economic Development, and the Seattle Music Commission, who all were involved with bringing this event to you today. Once again, I'm Alex Rose. I look forward to seeing you at the next one. Thank you so much.